We're shooting zombies and shooting more zombies. That's right, it's Resident Evil 3, the board game from Steamforged Games. In this carnage-based co-op, players take on the roles of survivors in the burnt-out burg of Raccoon City. Players must work together to repair an old cable car, then navigate through the city to reach and overcome a final encounter at the old clock tower. If they can survive over the course of several sessions worth of scenarios, they escape the city and win the game. Setup depends on your progress in the campaign. We're skipping the tutorial intro scenario today and building our first game in a new campaign. We start with character selection. Each player chooses a character and takes the matching profile card, one health track, and one health marker into their personal play area. The health marker begins on the fine space of the health track. Each character profile has a name, evade roll value, inventory limit, a list of starting items, and special rules. Players take the starting item cards as listed on their profile and place them in a row below the character. Weapon items with ammunition values also require an ammunition dial to be placed in the inventory. Turn to the starting value on the card. Next, set the Raccoon City dashboard to the side of the play area. At the start of the campaign, the danger marker is set on the starting space, but as the story progresses, it will increase. Shuffle the narrative event cards and place them face down on the narrative event slot. Next, take the item A cards, remove any showing this symbol, give the rest a shuffle. Place them on the corresponding slot of the dashboard. Next, take the item C cards and separate them by type, early, mid, and late level cards. Shuffle the late level cards first and place them on the item C slot of the dashboard, then do the same with the mid levels, placing them on top of the late stack, and complete that deck with the shuffled early level cards on top. Next comes scenario selection. At the start of a campaign, players can choose from the three unlocked scenarios in the scenario book: Downtown 1, Uptown 1, and Commercial 1. Downtown 1 is a great intro to the game, so we'll start with that. Following the layout instructions in the scenario book, place the game tiles in the central play area and add corresponding terrain elements in the form of tokens and cards. Such elements include doors, archways, walls, corpses, and more. For any locked doors, take the locked door cards and slide them under the door. Each scenario contains a list of cards for the item B deck. Gather those, shuffle them all together, and place them on the dashboard in their spot. Take the tension cards, remove any with this symbol, then shuffle the remaining cards to form the tension deck, placing it on the dashboard. Finally, each player takes their corresponding mini and places it on one of the two starting positions of the game tiles. Players may select either spot, but at least one player must be on each position. Gameplay occurs in turns, starting with a player of your choice and proceeding clockwise. Turns are divided into three phases: action phase, reaction phase, and tension phase. First up in the action phase, the active player may take four actions from a list of six total. They can take the same action multiple times if they wish. Actions include move, which allows the character model to move to an adjacent square, including diagonally, if they can access it. Walls, closed doors, and other obstacles might prevent movement between certain spaces. Generally, an open door or an archway is the access point to different squares. Additionally, red lines are walls, and you can't move through walls. Because I can't. I've tried. Each square on a tile can hold a maximum of four models. The medium-sized models count as two when calculating this capacity. When moving, if a player enters a tile with an encounter token, they flip that token and roll the encounter die to see what occurs. The result is based on the encounter dice table listed on that current scenario. Open or close a door. The active character can flip a door token if they're in the same square as that door. Search. This allows the character to remove an item token in their square and draw a card from the corresponding deck. They can only do this if they have enough room in their inventory to take that item. However, as a free action during this phase, the character is allowed to discard an item. Trade. The active character can exchange any number of item cards in their inventory with another character in their square. Use item. I think you know what this action does, but we'll just explain it anyway. This allows the character to use an item in their inventory, resolving the text on the card, and then discarding it. Now, weapons and some scenario-based items aren't discarded in this way. And finally, attack. If a character has a weapon item, they may perform an attack against an enemy in range. However, if any enemies share a square with the character, they must attack one of those enemies. Let's look at the weapon cards. Each has a name, ammo capacity, knives don't have this stat because they're knives, range, attack dice, hit effects, and special symbols which might provide unique rules for that item. Attacks resolve in the following order of operations. The player declares a target, which must be in range, noted on the item card, and be in line of sight. Line of sight can be achieved through open doors, archways, and just wide open areas. If a straight, uninterrupted line can be drawn between the character and the target, the attack is allowed. The player then spends one ammunition from the corresponding dial, if the weapon has one. The player then rolls the attack dice indicated. If a hit symbol is rolled, the attack succeeds. There are several hit symbols which provide hit effects based on the weapon. Some push the target one square adjacent, provided they don't cross a wall or a corner. Others deal damage tracked with wound tokens on the enemy's reference card, which have a hit point value in their top right. If the wounds equal or exceed that number, the enemy is killed and the model is removed from the play area. Some weapons have a rapid fire feature, which allows the attacker to spend up to an additional 2 ammunition to roll an additional attack die per ammo point. Others have special symbol abilities which trigger when that symbol is rolled on the attack die. One important rule. When a player resolves an attack against an enemy, the noise from combat attracts more attention. Enemies will perform an out-of-sequence reaction. This occurs in the action phase, but I'll explain it once we understand a little bit more about how enemies react. So, once the active player has taken their 4 actions, play proceeds to the reaction phase. The active player performs a reaction for each enemy on their same square or any linked squares, which are all squares either on that tile or connected by open doors or archways. The player chooses the order in which to resolve each enemy. Enemy cards have enemy type, threat level, movement value, hit points, and attack effect. If any enemy is in range and line of sight on the active character, it makes a basic attack. If multiple enemies fulfill this, only the enemy with the highest threat level makes the attack. If the enemy is not in range, it will move its move value worth of squares toward the active character. The exception to this is if the enemy already shares a square with another character. They're too busy toying with their current victim. When a basic attack occurs, the player rolls evade dice equal to their evade stat. There are 3 evasion symbols, level 1, 2, and 3. If any are rolled, the player dodges the attack. However, if there are larger or multiple enemies in attack range, a higher level evade symbol is needed to get away. The table on page 12 of the rulebook lists the minimum level evade symbol needed against different sizes or numbers of enemies. If the evade roll fails, the character is hit and suffers the hit effects listed on that enemy card. As a consolation, a hit character can push the enemy one square adjacent. Now, those out-of-sequence reactions, which occur during the action phase. When a player resolves an attack, enemies in linked squares not hit by that attack all perform a move action toward the character, unless they share a square with another character already. If a character tries any action in the same square as an enemy, the enemy with the highest threat level there performs a basic attack. If a character attacks an enemy in their own square and succeeds, other enemies in that square won't react. But if the character's attack fails, the targeted enemy immediately performs a basic attack which cannot be evaded. After all the reactions have been resolved by the player, play proceeds to the tension phase. The active player draws the top card from the tension deck and resolves the text. There are three types of tension cards in ascending order of danger: green, amber, and red. Thankfully, there are many green cards in the deck, but those red cards contain dire events, like zombies breaking through windows or doors. If the player cannot resolve the text on a tension card, they discard it and draw two more cards instead. Additionally, some tension cards have a duration effect lasting a round, which lasts until the end of that player's next turn. Gameplay continues with players exploring, searching, and fighting. Once the objective of the scenario has either been completed or failed, the one-time end phase begins. Follow the steps on page 26 of the rulebook based on your outcome. If players fail, they can attempt the same scenario again or try another. In both cases, the city danger level is raised by 1 for a successful completion and 2 for a failure. As the danger level increases, some tension cards with symbols matching the marker's current level on the track can activate when drawn. If the marker ever reaches the last space, the players lose the campaign. They'll start from the beginning on their next session. There are many other mechanics in Resident Evil 3. Here's some of the highlights of the important ones. Your health track. As players take damage, their health tracker moves toward danger, and as they heal, back towards fine. If they would take damage on the tracker past the danger level, their character becomes unconscious. The player sets their model on its side and skips their turns until they can be resuscitated by another player with a first aid spray. Importantly, players cannot complete a scenario if one of the characters is unconscious. They must resuscitate them first. No player left behind. If they can't be resuscitated, then the character dies and the scenario fails. Special attacks. Some enemies have special attacks listed below their basic attack, which activate when they would make a basic attack as part of their reaction in the reaction phase. This can only occur if their special attack symbol matches the symbol in the effect box of the most recently discarded tension card. Campaign progression tokens. These are located in mini scenarios, and once a player reaches the same square as one of these tokens, the corresponding campaign path card is added to the city dashboard with its locked side up if applicable. That path can be unlocked if the character discards the items shown on the card, either during their turn or in the end phase. If players can complete the scenarios before reaching the end of the danger track, including the final encounter scenarios at the clock tower, they'll escape the city and win the game. And that's the basics of Resident Evil 3, the board game. I'm Becca Scott. This is Good Time Society, and you better be careful because there's a ton of zombies in this game. You're probably gonna get bit. But before you do, be sure and like this video, subscribe to the channel, and come back soon for more great games and good times. We'll see you later.